come join me for an awesome workout while we review the sensory distribution of nerves to the upper limb. At the end of the session, I'll reveal the answer to the clinical vignette just presented. For a review of sensory distribution to the lower limb, click on the link above. So how does this all work? You follow along with the exercises while I discuss the nerves. To help incorporate movement with learning, you'll be slapping, tapping, or hitting the region of the upper limb to which the nerve provides sensory innervation. You ready to do this? Let's go.
But before getting into the exercises, let's first review the formation of the brachial plexus. Recall that C5 and C6 come together to form the superior trunk. C7 remains on its own to become the middle trunk, and C8 and T1 come together to form the inferior trunk. All three of the trunks divide into a posterior and anterior division. The posterior divisions from all three trunks come together to form the posterior cord, while the anterior divisions from the superior and middle trunks come together to form the lateral cord, and the anterior division from the inferior trunk becomes the medial cord. The medial, lateral, and posterior cords branch to form the five terminal branches of the brachial plexus. These are the nerves we'll be discussing today. Axillary nerve. Everybody say it with me. Axillary nerve. The axillary nerve provides cutaneous innervation to the lateral shoulder. So while you're planking, be sure to tap those shoulders. This is easy enough to remember, since the nerve also provides motor innervation to the deltoid muscle, which is located just deep to this same patch of skin. This area is frequently referred to as the badge patch area, because it is the location that a badge is likely to be placed on a uniform. The axillary nerve is a branch off the posterior cord and can be viewed posteriorly as it exits the quadrangular space. Due to the nerve's close proximity to the glenohumeral joint, it can be easily damaged as a result of a shoulder dislocation or fracture of the neck of the humerus. Radial nerve. Say it with me. Radial nerve. To represent this nerve, we'll do sit-ups, but on the way down, be sure to slap the back of your arm, forearm, and hand against the ground, because the radial nerve provides sensory innervation to the posterior arm, forearm, and hand. In fact, whenever you hear the word posterior in reference to the upper limb, you should immediately begin thinking radial nerve, since it also provides motor innervation to the posterior muscles of the arm and forearm, and the nerve is also derived from the posterior cord. Getting back to the actual nerve, the radial nerve wraps around the humerus posteriorly, heading toward the lateral elbow or epicondyle. At about the location of the elbow, it bifurcates into the deep radial nerve, a strictly motor branch, and the superficial radial, which is strictly sensory. The superficial radial travels down the lateral forearm where it emerges along the posterior edge of the brachioradialis muscle. The nerve then heads toward the dorsum of the hand, crossing superficial to the anatomical snuffbox on its way. The nerve's integrity is tested along the first dorsal web space. Ulnar nerve. Planks again, but this time hammer fist the ground, because the ulnar nerve provides sensory innervation to the medial side of the hand, as well as the palmar and dorsal surfaces of the medial 1.5 fingers, meaning the pinky and half the ring finger. So say it with me. Ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve. The ulnar nerve is a branch off the medial cord and travels down the arm towards the medial epicondyle. The nerve is easily damaged at this location, which anyone who has ever hit their funny bone is acutely aware of. In the forearm, the nerve travels with the ulnar artery toward the wrist. At some point in the forearm, the nerve gives off the dorsal ulnar branch, which is responsible for its sensory distribution to the dorsum side of the hand. Once in the wrist, the main ulnar nerve divides into a superficial and a deep branch. The deep ulnar nerve is solely a motor branch, while the superficial ulnar carries sensation from the ventral side of the hand. Knowing these branches and their function is crucial for determining where an insult to the nerve may have occurred. If sensation is lost along the ulnar distribution of both the palmar and the dorsal surfaces, then the injury must be proximal to the dorsal ulnar branch. If either side of the hand is spared, however, the injury must have occurred distal to the branching. Median nerve. And back to sit-ups. But this time, on the way up, slap the palm of your hand against the ground. This is because the median nerve provides sensory innervation to the palmar side of the hand, or at least the radial side of the palm, as well as the palmar surface of 3.5 fingers. Now say it with me. Median nerve. Median nerve. As for the formation of the median nerve, it receives contributions from both the medial and lateral cords. The nerve then travels down the arm with the brachial artery. Just distal to the elbow, it dives between the two heads of pronator teres, where the nerve is susceptible to compression. The median nerve travels down the forearm between the tendons of flexor digitorum superficialis and flexor digitorum profundus. It passes through the carpal tunnel with the same tendons as well as with the tendon of flexor pollicis longus. Swelling of the synovium surrounding those tendons can compress the median nerve, resulting in carpal tunnel syndrome. Common symptoms of carpal tunnel syndrome include pain, numbness, and tingling in the thumb, index finger, middle finger, and the radial half of the ring finger. Medial antebrachial cutaneous. As its name suggests, the medial antebrachial cutaneous nerve provides sensory innervation to the medial or ulnar side of the forearm. That means it's perfect for planking down to your forearms. Say it with me. Medial antebrachial cutaneous. The medial antebrachial cutaneous branches off the medial cord just before the cord gives off the ulnar nerve. Loss of sensation to the medial forearm can help to differentiate an ulnar nerve injury from a more proximal injury, such as one to the inferior trunk. If both the medial forearm and the medial hand are involved, then the injury must be to a parent branch of the two nerves, meaning the inferior trunk, as a likely possibility. Lateral antebrachial cutaneous. Say the name with me. Lateral antebrachial cutaneous. As its name suggests, the lateral antebrachial cutaneous nerve provides sensory innervation to the lateral or radial side of the forearm. As you perform the V-ups, be sure to pronate your forearms so that the lateral side slaps against your legs. The nerve is the terminal portion of the musculocutaneous nerve. The name musculocutaneous tells you everything you need to know about the nerve. It starts off muscular, as it provides motor innervation to the muscles of the anterior arm, and then becomes cutaneous in the forearm via its lateral antebrachial cutaneous branch. You're lucky I don't have much to say about this nerve, because V-ups are hard.
Are you ready to mix it up a little bit? This time, I'll call out the nerve and you lead the exercise. If you don't remember what the movements are, just make it up as you go. But be sure to slap yourself in the correct region. After a few seconds, I'll join in to make sure you're on the right track.
Ulnar nerve. Axillary nerve. Medial antebrachial cutaneous. Median nerve. Lateral antebrachial cutaneous. Radial nerve. Back to the case presentation. The nerve that was most likely damaged was the superficial radial nerve, which provides sensory innervation to the lateral or radial side of the dorsum of the hand. The integrity of the nerve is tested along the first dorsal web space. The nerve also travels superficial to the anatomical snuff box, which also marks the location of the scaphoid bone. Thus, surgeons operating on the scaphoid bone need to take care not to damage this nerve.